So bonjour and welcome to this opening press conference of COP21. We would traditionally have this on Monday, but as you know, Monday is kind of a busy day. So we've taken the opportunity to have our opening press conference today. I'm very delighted to have with me His Excellence Laurent Fabius, the Minister of Foreign Affairs of France, and COP21 President-Designate, which is the official title. And on my right, of course, I have Christiana Figueres, who is the Executive Secretary of the UN Framework Convention on Climate Change. I'm going to ask first His Excellency to make some opening remarks, then Christiana Figueres, and then we'll move to questions and answers from the media, and if you can say who you are and where you're from, that would be very helpful. You have French and English simultaneous translation, so please avail yourselves of the headsets. Thank you very much.
Merci beaucoup.
Thank you very much. I will be speaking French, and this is because there is interpretation, so you can put on your headsets and listen to me in English. First of all, I would like to welcome Christiana Figueres to Paris. She now has the keys in her hand of the house. And ladies and gentlemen from the press, I would also like to welcome you very warmly. The press and the media are going to play a very important role during this conference. And I have been told that you are going to be 3,500 media people, journalists, here during COP21. And on Monday, on the day of the heads of state and government being present, there will be 6,000 journalists. And there will be special spaces so that you can work in a comfortable manner. I would like to give the key here to the conference center to Christiana Figueres, and during the COP21, this will therefore be a United Nations space. For 2 weeks, therefore, the entire world will be coming here. We wished this space to reflect our common commitment to our planet, but also to show that civilian society can work hand in hand with us. And this is why we wanted the form to reflect the substance of what we are going to be discussing. In 48 hours, COP21 will be beginning. In fact, it was in Durban that we had already committed to this particular date. And since then, Christiana Figueres has worked with the different presidents to prepare for 2015, which is going to be the turning point and which is what the world requires. As I and as France has the chair, we have done our utmost to support the negotiation processes, and our aim is that each country should feel that they have been heard, that they have been consulted, that they have been able to express themselves freely, and going well beyond government-level discussions, this should trickle down to all levels of society. With our Peruvian friends and colleagues, particularly Manuel Pico Vida, who is the outgoing president, I can say that we've had excellent relations and very warm and good working conditions. As I said, we wish every country to be able to express itself and be heard. This is what we have committed to. Our president has committed to this as well. And I myself, over the last year, have actually had more than 100 different trips that are connected to the Connect Climate Conference and 400 bilateral meetings. And our ambassadors have been working extremely actively all over the world. We can say that the Paris Conference truly reflects hope, the hope that we feel. And here we can say that it is something that reflects commitments at all levels, the government, civilians, business, and young people, old people, whatever. We all realize that things have to change, and Paris wishes to speed up those changes. There are many discussions that are underway. There are concrete proposals that will be made. Some will be made during the conference. I'll give you a simple figure. Approximately 11,000 commitments have been made so far on NASCA, which has been set up by the United Nations for this particular purpose. Various states and governments have worked very hard as well, because each country had to present their climate goals for the years ahead. And Christiana Figueres told me that yesterday we reached the figure of 180 INDCs that have been stated, and 95% of them represent world emissions. This is unheard of. This is extremely exciting, because I think this is a real sign of success. I'd just like to say that the Kyoto Protocol, for example, only covers 15% of emissions. Today, this covers 95% of emissions. So I think this shows truly how committed we are. It shows also that there are real innovations underway. There are new models of development as well. Of course, these INDCs are not as yet absolutely 100%, but it does move us away from the 5 to 6 degrees that the IPCC had described as being the do-nothing scenario. And I think, therefore, that this will be an extremely important time during the Paris conference to see how we can fill that gap. Now, I won't go into all the details of the negotiations. You may have questions about this, but I would just like to say that the COP, of course, is going to have its main opening on Monday with heads of state and government. There will be 150 of them present. But as of tomorrow, the ADP group, which is working on the text, will be meeting. And therefore, this will allow us once again to have discussions on the text itself without wasting any time. Monday, we will be having many meetings taking place, and I've asked the co-chairs of the ADP to prepare and give us the first draft of this text with some of the changes that have been added on Saturday at noon. Then that will bring us to the second phase, where we will actually start with the COP, and I will be taking over, France will be taking over, and we will present proposals about how to conclude our work. I hope that the text that we get on Saturday will be as complete as possible, so that the second week will be spent mainly with the major political issues and some items that remain pending. I'd also like to say that my presidency is going to be one which is impartial, open to hearing from all, reaching compromises whenever we can. And that is what the COP presidents has to achieve. This is what we're going to try and do. But on the 11th of December, I would like to be able to say 6 simple words, which would be an indication of the end, to say that the Paris Accord has been approved. Thank you.
Indeed. Christiana Figueres.
Thank you very much, Nick, and good afternoon to the medias of the press. May I start by thanking Minister Fabius, incoming COP president. He will be our COP president as of Monday morning at about 10:16. By then, you should be our COP president, and we're very much looking forward to that. And thank you very much, Minister Fabius, for the leadership that you have shown throughout a whole year. Because this is Paris is an event, but it is also a process. Today, I would like to share with you that just a few minutes ago, we have received the very sad news that Maurice Strong, who was one of the architects of the Earth Summit 1992, has actually passed away. That, in addition to showing our sentiments to his family, it also reminds us that Paris comes in a very important tradition of increasing efforts of society to deal with climate change. The convention itself was born in 1992 at the Earth Summit under very much the leadership of Maurice Strong. And then after, we went into the Kyoto Protocol period, which was the only legally binding instrument under the convention and still in operation and in validity until 2020. What is being negotiated here and finalized, because many pieces are already in place, but what is being finalized here in Paris over the next 2 weeks is none other than the second legally binding instrument under the convention that will then go into effect in 2020 once we are through with the Kyoto Protocol. So the Paris COP comes in a very, very important sequence of efforts and of legal steps that we as a whole, as humanity, have been taking for quite a few years to address climate change. This particular step that we will be finalizing here was started in Durban, in South Africa, in 2011, when all countries came together to decide that by 2015, and we did not know then that we would be in Paris, but by 2015, they would come to the global agreement. They have been working on this, all governments, all sectors of human society have been working on this endeavor since then, and we are delighted to now come to the final resolution of that effort. Minister Fabius, you may be happy to know that as we have been walking through this beautiful venue this morning, we now moved not only 130, but we now have 183 national climate change plans. And this is what we have seen over the past few months, that these national climate change plans just continue to come in. So you can do the math yourself. We now have 183 out of 194 total countries that are parties to the convention. As Minister Fabius has said, we have almost 95% of global greenhouse gas emissions already covered by national climate change plans. It is the first time in history that so many countries have actually incurred into the exercise of doing their own analysis at home to figure out and quantify how they can contribute to the solution. Let me say that I think that even before the COP21 starts officially, which is on Monday morning, this is already the first very concrete success of COP21 that throughout this past year, under the leadership of the incoming president and of the outgoing president of Peru, we have actually already had 183 climate change plans. The second show of success already, even before we start COP21, is the fact, as Minister Fabius has mentioned, that we have so much action already occurring from thousands of actors, some of which will be highlighted throughout this week in the Lima-Paris action agenda, some of which are on the NASCA portal, many of which are still remaining to be uploaded. This is a problem that we're actually delighted to have. We just don't have enough people to upload the huge enthusiasm that is coming from cities, from provinces, from investors, from companies, all over the world, north and south, east and west, understanding fundamentally one thing, that it is in their interest to address climate change. That's why they're doing it. Because what before was thought that addressing climate change was going to be only a burden has now over time, and in particular over the past year, been shown that we do not need to choose between economic development, between security and addressing climate change, but rather that these two things go hand in hand. That it is in addressing climate change, in bringing down emissions, in increasing the resilience, that we are actually setting a much firmer foundation for development, for economic growth, for water security, food security, energy security. So those, all of those agendas have actually been found to be reinforcing of each other. And we will be seeing throughout the next 2 weeks even more proof of this fundamental truth until we get to the final resolution of the Paris Agreement at the end of next week. With that, let me just finally say that I would like to thank each and every one of you, the members of the media, because addressing climate change is such a complex issue. It is full of so many acronyms and so many concepts that actually are competing with each other and interlinked with each other, that for you, the job of communicating what is happening here in this venue to the outside world is a very, very challenging job, and it is a very important job. Minister Fabius, who will be President Fabius as of Monday, and I commit to doing our very best to communicating from our side as clearly as possible to you, knowing that you will then help us to communicate further to the outside world. We're going to make a commitment to try to not use any strange words, because we do create strange words all the time. And so Minister Fabius will speak in his flawless French. I shall try to do a similar job in English, but truly in languages that are understood. And we very much appreciate the effort that you're going to make, because this is not something that is to stay in Paris. It certainly should not stay in Le Bourget. The message that is being created and constructed here is a message for the world and needs to get out to every corner of the world. And it is only through you that we will be able to do that. So I thank you.
Thank you very much indeed. Right, let's take some questions. That hand was up pretty fast there, so if we got a microphone, yeah.
Hello,
I'm Emmanuel Jarry from the agency Solitaire. I think we can presume that in the final agreement, well, anyway, that the carbon price should be fixed. In fact, business, industry, and all the others say that one has to fix that carbon price so that encourage people to move away from a carbon-intensive economy. So what's going to happen during the conference? Can we expect, for example, strong commitments from countries to, in the short term, to establish some sort of carbon market or tax to guarantee this? Yes, well, I'll answer that question in French. The question of fixing a carbon price or tariff is something that can be done in many different ways, and it is a very important question. There are initiatives that have already been taken in this area. There are parts of the world or regions that have already fixed a carbon price. China, for example, has said that in 2017, which is not that far away, there will be a fixed carbon price all over China, which would be valid for the whole of China. Now, why is this so important? Well, if we wish to move towards a low-carbon or decarbonized world where we can have sustainable development, you've got to have two-pronged movements. You've got to obviously have a price for the carbon, whereas it has a cost. And you also have to make sure that renewable sources of energy are cheaper and more accessible. So those are the two areas in which we've got to move simultaneously. And this is why there have been many different attempts to fix the carbon price or rate. Now, is this going to be part of the final agreement? Well, in the long document which has been proposed, as I remember things correctly, there are two carbon prices that I mentioned. But I think it would perhaps be a bit utopic to think that in the agreement, which I hope we are going to reach, that we will be able to fix a single carbon price. I hope this price will be mentioned, or the idea of a carbon price will be mentioned in the final agreement. But of course, there are differences from region to region and also in the methods or techniques used to fix this price. The other point is that as of Monday, there will be very strong initiatives taken to stress how important it is to move towards carbon pricing in as many countries as possible. And these initiatives will be carried by governments, but also by business and companies. Therefore, during the week, starting from Monday, there will be steps and initiatives taken along these lines. And I think that these lines are obviously the right way to go. That is that we should move as quickly as possible to a carbon rating and pricing system.
No. Second question, the lady in the front here.
From China Central Television. We just want to know what are the major obstacles to reach agreement during this 12 days meeting.
Avant de parler.
Well, before I talk about obstacles, if you allow me, let me talk about the positive points that I'd like to raise and which exist. First of all, we could say that everywhere in the world there seems to be greater awareness of the importance of climate issues, and which of course are leading to greater climate change all over the world, and the effects have been felt all over the world. I think people, our populations, our governments are all aware of that. So that's the first point. There is a greater awareness, and this is something that is extremely positive. Second point, scientists have published extremely valid, sound work corroborating these facts. And I think we have to also commend the work that has been carried out by the IPCC. Thirdly, many of the large carbon emitters have committed themselves as well in a very decisive way to fighting climate change. China, for example, is a good example. The United States, others as well. And all these elements are extremely positive. And in fact, we hadn't made so much progress in these different areas before. And I think the best proof of this has just been given to us by Mrs. Figueres, who has just said that 183 countries have set their national plans concerning her climate issues. And this is extremely good news and is really quite exciting. When we started working on this in Lima last year, we really didn't expect to achieve these sort of results. And also there are preparatory work that have been undertaken, which have not been concluded as yet. And the group that's going to be meeting as of Sunday has got a document, has got a text, which is the base of the agreement. There's work to be done on it, of course, but it is there. And obviously there is a real desire to conclude satisfactorily. Now, obviously there are some issues that have to be settled, because there are some areas that are well known to all where we haven't been able to reach an agreement. I'd just like to mention some concepts, but I think you would probably understand what I'm talking about. For example, the question concerning the funding and financing of technology. We also have to reach agreements concerning adaptation, and also on the question concerning differentiation, which is another well-known point. Another question concerning the revision clauses. So there are these sort of issues that remain to be discussed. And we also must remember that countries objectively have different situations. For example, the Maldives that are probably going to be submerged in the near future are facing a very different set of circumstances compared to Canada, or India, or Bolivia. Each case is individual and different. I'm just mentioning these cases randomly. And therefore, we must realize that given the fact that there are these different individual cases, and the fact that we want to reach a legally binding global agreement, which is differentiated, but which is just and sustainable, and well, we have to reach a compromise. And that is, after all, the goal, because we do not wish to go beyond 2 degrees. Some are saying 1.5 degrees by the end of this century. So there are positive sides to these works in her progress. There are some points that still have to be settled, and these are the points that I wanted to raise with you.
Right. let's take one from over here, this lady here.
Bonjour, Yihan Hu, de China Business. Le président chinois.
The Chinese President, President Xi Jinping, is here as of day one. The Chinese delegation is already here. What are your expectations from China to reach a global agreement? And my second question, for the Chinese private sector, how can they, how can it actively participate so that we can reach a more green economy? The Chinese President is arriving on Sunday, I think. He will be dining with the French president Sunday evening. And the next day, on Monday, he will be here and he will be taking the floor. China is a country which has shown its commitment, that is perfectly clear, in resisting and fighting climate change. They have talked about a new green civilization, a new ecological civilization. This is how, what they call it. And I have been 11 times to China in the past year. And I can say that I have real proof that China is really committed. And it is, of course, indispensable to be so because they are the largest emitters of greenhouse gases worldwide. And therefore, there is a real requirement from a cultural, social, political point of view. And they must realize that this is, in fact, an economic opportunity as well. And this is why China has used it as an economic opportunity to, in fact, work on renewable sources of energy. We have worked on this. At the beginning of November, we issued a joint position, which was very well prepared. And this allows us to make quite a lot of progress in many different areas. And we hope that all the different countries will accept these proposals, given the fact that China has a very important role to play because of the emissions levels, but also because of its position in the world. We are therefore interested and impatient to hear what President Xi has to say on Monday. And of course, we have constant, regular contacts with the Chinese negotiating team. Now, concerning the private sector, of course, has a very important role to play in what Christiana Figueres was saying earlier on, that is to commit to a new development model. And many Chinese private entrepreneurs will be here. Jack Ma will be there. I think you all know of him. And we know that for one of the initiatives that is going to be launched on Monday to step up research in new technologies, which combines private and public entities, we've talked about Mr. Bill Gates being involved as well. Well, there will also be Chinese entrepreneurs and businessmen who will be involved and will be contributing.
Gentlemen, no, not you, Richard. The one behind you first. Sorry.
Hi, Nick Clark from Al Jazeera English. Christiana, if I may ask you, if we're not going to specifically hit the 2 degrees C target at this conference, what for you is the best outcome?
We will not be hitting the 2 degree outcome at this conference for a very simple reason. The reference year that is used for temperature increase is not 2015, it is 2100. And we're currently at 2015. That's where we are. So what is very important here is to make sure that we affirm and increase the turning point that we have already seen occur. Paris will not create a turning point because the turning point is already underway, but it needs to mark that turning point. And in order to mark that turning point with respect to temperature increases, the Paris Agreement will have to do two fundamental things. First, it shall have to recognize the national climate change plans, currently 183, but stay tuned. They may rise by this afternoon. So 183, which collectively take us off the trajectory that we were just a few years ago of a temperature increase of 4 or 5 or by some estimates 6 degrees. That is where we were going in our trajectory of temperature increase measured and projected to 2100. We are now, with the full implementation of the national climate change plans that we have on the table, we would be at a temperature increase that is anywhere between 2.7 and 3.5, depending on what you're counting and what your methodology and assumptions are. That is fundamental progress. So we are no longer in 4 degrees, 5 degrees, 6 degrees increase. We're now in the bandwidth of 2.7 to 3.5. A very, very important sign of progress, of technology, of policy, and of capital shifts. Is that enough? No. Because we do know that we have to actually be in the bandwidth of 1.5 to staying under 2 degrees. So for that delta, for that difference that we still have, that is why the Paris Agreement needs to do the second very important task, not just recognize the national climate change plans that we have as a first very important contribution to bending the curve of emissions, but also, secondly, chart the path of the continual decrease of emissions until we get the task done, until we are on the path of staying within the bandwidth of 1.5 to under 2 degrees. And that pathway is going to be constituted by first acknowledging that the INDCs are not enough. Secondly, in the Paris Agreement, setting a process of continuous improvement, if you will, of continuous increase of effort with clear milestones that could be every 5 years, but that remains to be decided, and with a very, very clear monitoring, reporting, and verification protocol that will be followed by all countries so that everyone will be able to know whether we're actually on the path of progress or not. So those three pieces would have to be there in that second effort that governments would have to make in addition to recognizing the INDCs or the National Climate Change Plans that are currently in process. So summing that up, we will have to recognize where we are. We will have to recognize where we have to be and by when. And we then have to chart the path of how do we get from where we are now to where we have to be.
Right. Gentleman over there.
Hello? Oh, there we go. You talked a little bit before about carbon.
Can you say who you are and where you're from?
Oh, sorry. Tom Mitchell from New Matilda magazine in Australia. You talked a little bit before about carbon trading. I'm just wondering if you think that as a cornerstone policy, a reverse auction where companies can bid and effectively be subsidized by government to reduce their emissions, whether or not you think that is sufficient as a policy in and of itself for tackling, on a national level, greenhouse gas emissions.
Well, Minister Fabius was actually not talking specifically about carbon trading. He was talking about a broader concept, which is pricing carbon. And you can price carbon in many different ways. You can do it through an emission trading system. You can do it through a carbon tax. We currently have 60 jurisdictions that have some kind of a system of pricing carbon. Two-thirds of them are some type of emission trading system. One-third are carbon tax systems. But the fundamentals remain the same. First, every country must decide what is the best way for their particular industry, for their particular national circumstances, for their particular natural resource base. It would be completely counterproductive for someone ex deo ex machina to decide how every country needs to put in place in financial incentives to begin to bring down their emissions. That is the wisdom of the variety of approaches, including reverse option, that Minister Fabius has referred to, because all of these jurisdictions, some of them national countries, some of them subnational governments, have actually used very, very different but nationally determined and nationally beneficial systems in how to price carbon one way or the other. What is going to be very interesting over time is to be able to derive lessons learned both within the jurisdiction but also across the jurisdiction of how does this actually play out and what lessons can be learned. The European emission trading system is a very good example of a system that has been in place for quite a few years, from which we have derived many lessons of what to do and what not to do in the future. Each of these systems, including the Australian, will be a very, very important learning ground, and eventually we will be able to get to the linking of all of these systems that could then lead to a much more standardized carbon price and a much more standardized unit of a ton. But that is not where we are right now.
Yes, Alistair Doyle.
Thank you very much, Alistair Doyle from Reuters. There are thousands, hundreds of marches happening this weekend around the world. I wonder if you could tell us what impact this will have on the talks if they gather record numbers of people, let's say. And also, could you tell us, Mr. Fabius, about the marches here in France? I understand that there have been some environmental activists who've been arrested in the run-up to this march or the whatever they were going to do. Could you tell us why they've been detained, please? Thank you.
Merci.
Thank you. Yes, there are going to be many marches organized worldwide, and I think that's very positive. Question, and this is because governments realize that their populations, citizens, civil society are mobilized to stand up against climate change and deregulation. And I think these marches usually are very peaceful marches. Now, in France, as you probably know, we were subjected to extremely serious and severe attacks 2 weeks ago, and the government took a decision, which was not an easy one, to not allow marches or other public events for which we couldn't guarantee full security. If they are, in fact, in a closed environment, of course, we can guarantee a certain amount of safety and security. But if you've got thousands of people walking or marching, of course, there are risks that we may not be able to manage quite in the same way and the right way. This is why the French government decided to ban marches, and most of the associations and organizations have been very responsible in their reactions to this decision. Now, I know that here and there, there have been some house arrests, and just a little while ago, the French President of the Republic was receiving representatives from her NGOs, and during that particular meeting, he stated quite clearly that there should be no decision which is completely arbitrary should be taken. And I think this means that if there were to be different intentions, then that's a separate issue. But if an activist, environmental or a green activist, wish to move around, of course, there's no problem with that. So there are no arbitrary arrests.
Yes, could I add that I actually just came this morning from a very moving event of the faith communities of the world, all different faiths of the world. And they have walked 280,000 kilometers in all different continents. They have arrived here in Paris. 280,000 kilometers is the equivalent of having walked 7 times around the world. They have walked and arrived here in Paris with beautiful symbols that they have collected along the way. They have arrived with 1,800,000 signatures of people from every single country in the world who are supporting an ambitious climate agreement here in Paris. That was a very meaningful and beautiful event that crystallizes, I think, the sentiment out there. We do know that the French government had, understandably, to cancel the march that was planned here in France for the reasons that Minister Fabius has shared with you, but I think everybody understands that. We do know that there will be thousands of marches in many, many cities around the world, almost in every country, that will be reflecting the sentiment of support for an ambitious climate agreement here in Paris. Because those marches are occurring in other cities and in other countries, and because the march that was meant to be here in Paris has sadly but justifiably had to be canceled, we are working with the organizers of that large march to install here in Le Bourget a very, very large screen where we will be projecting the visual images from all of those marches around the world. We will be projecting all kinds of symbolic, artistic expressions from people who want to have their voice heard, and they want to have their voice heard here in Le Bourget. And of course, despite the fact that this is the largest COP that we've ever had, and the largest venue that we've ever had, we cannot have 7 billion people here, but there are many people who would like their voice heard. So we are working with the organizers of these civil society movements to bring as many voices in to Le Bourget so that those can also play the part here in a very important session that starts on Monday. And I do think that the summary of the voices is that there is a very, very strong moral imperative to act now on climate change. There is also a very strong economic imperative to act now on climate change. There is a very strong technological imperative to act now on climate change. And the next 2 weeks will show that there's also a strong political imperative.
Right. I think in the end we can take probably two more questions and then we'll have to wrap it up. So Richard, we'll take you first.
Thank you very much. Richard Black, reporting for Business Green here. I wonder if one of you could perhaps clear up this issue of the likely legal form of the outcome, because I think it's something that still confuses people. The Times of London today has an article that's very confused about the likely legal nature of the outcome. So I think it might be useful if you could clarify for us which bits might have legal force and which bits won't have legal force, so there's no more confusion. Thank you.
Sorry, would you like to take it? I wish I could give you a very, very clear answer now, but that still is a conversation that is ongoing. What I can share with you is that I hear increasing support for a Paris Agreement that will be internationally legally binding. I hear increasing support for that. What is important to understand is that there is going to be quite a few fundamental differences between this Paris Agreement that, as I said before, is the second legally binding instrument under the convention, but is going to be remarkably different from the first legally binding instrument under the convention, which was the Kyoto Protocol. There will be many differences between the Kyoto Protocol and the Paris Agreement. One of those differences is the one that you're asking about, which is the Kyoto Protocol is, if you will, monolithically internationally legally binding. That means every single element of the Kyoto Protocol has the same legal bindingness. And I'm sorry that that word doesn't exist, but in this case, we have to create it. Whereas the Paris Agreement will have different elements that have different nature of legal bindingness. Exactly how that is going to be decided still remains to be seen and is one of the complexities that we will be keeping you up to date on.
Okay, we'll take off. Sorry, I just said two. This gentleman here, last question. Thank you.
Thank you. Tom D'Alessio from Next City. What role should actions from COP21 play in developing a new urban agenda as part of Habitat 3?
As far les villes.
Well, if we're talking about cities, well, it's quite clear that cities are going to play a very vital role, particularly also in this conference. And this is because cities, of course, or urban areas play a very important role in fighting climate change. And it's going to reach its apex on the 4th of December. And this is because on the 4th of December at the Mairie de Paris, the Paris Town Hall, there will be 1,000 cities or representatives of cities from different regions from the world who will be present. And they will be taking very specific commitments concerning the way in which they are going to fight climate change. Now, what does this mean in practical terms? It means that they're going to adopt a charter and they're going to adopt various commitments concerning public transport, waste management, circular economy, also the energy savings incentives, and anything that actually emits greenhouse gases. And this can be done in different ways depending on the country or the cities. Because obviously governments play an important role, and a very important role. But when you actually look at who is emitting greenhouse gases, you see that it's industries, companies, cities, regions, people. And therefore, I think one of the innovative aspects of this conference is of course, there is the agreement that Christiana was talking about earlier on, and that will be a determining factor. We do want to reach a global agreement, and of course, that is the most difficult part that has to be achieved. But the contributions of cities, of regions, of companies, of civil society will be massive, and that is what we wished for as well. With Manuel Bugadival, and with the United Nations, we launched the Paris-Lima Action Agenda. That's what it's all about. That means that we're not only dealing with governments, but NGOs as well, and urban authorities. Jerry Brown, for example, is going to speak, Michael Bloomberg as well, Mrs. Hidalgo. And there will be representatives of Chinese cities, African cities. And they will not only talk about their plans, but also about what really needs to be done. And all of this will be on the NASCA platform. And this represents gigawatts, not only for the far future, but for right away. And we hope that this is really going to convince people that things are underway and that we're moving in the right direction. And your question is absolutely essential. And I think that the Paris conference is going to allow us to go one step further compared to the work that has existed up till now on these issues.
Right. Thank you very much. Ms. Figueres?
Do you want to do it? Okay. Well, Nick has suggested that I clarify for some of you, because Minister Fabius has been speaking about the NASCA platform, as I have. Just It is actually one of the sites that you might want to visit. It is spelled N-A-Z, not S, N-A-Z-C-A, the NASCA platform, and it is a very impressive site that brings together the commitments, thousands of commitments from thousands of stakeholders who are in incremental fashion making their commitments public of how they're going to contribute to both adaptation and mitigation. So it is a site that would be interesting for you to visit.
And for the English speakers there, it's N-A-Z-C-A rather than Z, just so we can clear up that kind of language complexity. But it's a non-state actor zone for climate action, so it's worth having a look. I think we've come to the end. Thank you very much for all being here. Thank you so much to the Minister. Thank you so much to Christiana. And have a fantastic 2 weeks.